just again because of their history and their young players are fun to watch. But the Orioles are such a good team as well, and the Angels, you know, they're down two games, but it's happened before. I could see a team like the Angels coming back. I mean, there are so many quality teams in these playoffs and this postseason that I think that'd be fun to watch in a World Series. And I don't know how much that translates into viewership and the real excitement, because the reality is, as a baseball fan, I'd watch any World Series. I don't care who's playing, you know. But I think for the interest of baseball and for hopefully a sport, I think there's some really quality matchups that maybe gets people interested again, because let's face it, I mean, baseball really is kind of on the lower end as far as interest from people. I mean, people much more interested, obviously, in the NFL. That's another stratosphere. But even NBA, in the last few years, because of the Heat and what they've done, the interest level has been higher there in major, you know, games and finals and championships. So I'd love to see a really good World Series that sparks, you know, national interest from people in the game.
Channel 10's Will Manso joins us here on the Amigo Show. By the way, John Jay, one of our listeners texting in, reminding me John Jay plays for the Cardinals. Another Cubanito here from South Florida. But you're right about baseball, actually from the U. Yes, Frank reminding me of that. When it comes to baseball, you're right. And I got the opportunity. I don't know if you knew this or not. I flew out to New York last Thursday with my 9-year-old and went to Yankee Stadium to see Jeter's final game in the Cathedral. And it reminded me. What reminded me as to what was my love affair with Jeter, it was the fact that I had been kind of done with baseball after the 94 season went on strike. I was really upset. And being a lifelong baseball fan, I thought that they were just a bunch of prima donnas. And then all of a sudden, the Yankees started showing some relevance in 95. They played okay. And this young kid coming up through the ranks that was going to be a stud shortstop named Derek Jeter came into the scene. Actually, his true rookie year, 96, although he played probably a dozen games or so in 95. And that's, I think, what kept my interest in baseball as a Yankee fan, as a guy who wanted to see a face for baseball as we had grown up seeing different guys along the way. He's gone. This is so good for the game because I don't know who that face is going to be. Like, if you had to choose one person, who would that face be, Will?
Well, and number one is, I don't know if there'll ever be anyone like Jeter again. And I don't mean that Jeter was one of a kind, because there was a lot, you know, there was a lot over the years, the Cal Ripkins, Robin Yount, Tony Gwynn's, going further back, obviously the Ted Williams, players like that, you know, those rare players that come up young, are stars young, and remain that way with one team. It's just very hard to find. I think right now the obvious choice is Mike Trout. I mean, I think he's a dynamic player who started at 18, 19 years old, is about to win his first MVP, already could have two other MVPs. I mean, Cabrera certainly deserved the MVPs the last couple of years to be in that conversation, but Trout could have easily won as well. I think he's a guy that the Angels already locked up. He could be a guy that has a 20-year career in baseball, playing for the Angels, winning multiple MVPs, World Series, and being the face of baseball. And I also think we've got one right here in Giancarlo Stanton. And that's why there's so much interest this offseason if the Marlins really do. You know, I've said this before. The Marlins can gather so much goodwill among jaded baseball fans in this town for the moves that they've made in the past by re-signing Giancarlo Stanton to a long-term deal, because he is in this now dying, you know, outside of – obviously guys still take PED, but to the level that it was in the true PED era – he is one of the only true sluggers that can put up those stats like we saw consistently in the PED era. Look at the numbers this year. Very few players are 40 home run, 120 RBI types anymore. And Giancarlo Stanton's one of those, and he's just entering his prime. So I think Stanton and Trout are the two guys that just stand out, and it's no surprise that they had the best two offensive seasons in baseball this year.
Well, Manso on the air with us here on the Amigo Show. Dolphins last week in London, they put a shellacking on the Raiders. Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, that seems to be a lot of the story of a lot of NFL teams, including the Miami Dolphins. But now, I hate to get overly optimistic a quarter of the way through the season, but the Pats don't look so good. I ain't scared of the Bills and the Jets. So, like, you go into a bye week 2-2 wondering, who are we? Are we the team we saw in London, or are we the team that got our butts whooped by Kansas City?
Well, I think the answer is they're the same team that we've kind of seen the last, you know, 6-7 years. You know, they're a team that is so up and down, and it gets you hooked in with a good performance and then slaps you in the face with reality sometimes. But I think the difference is this year is that you don't have to go 12-4. You know, and I highly doubt. I never count out Tom Brady, because I know at 37, there's no doubt he is on the decline. But that doesn't mean he's a bad player. I just think right now they're not playing well. They don't have a lot of talent around him, a lot of weapons around him. it wouldn't surprise me if the Patriots had it continued on with a bad season instead of 7-9 or 8-8. That's, I think, the real story for the Dolphins. Not that I think the Dolphins are that good that they could reel off and go 11-5 and 12-4 and be a division winner and a top seed in the playoffs, because it probably won't take more than 9-7 to win that division. And with that being the case, could this team go 9-7? Absolutely. Again, what does that mean to fans? You know, you had the team a few years ago in Sperano's first year. Remember when they went, what was it, 11-5, won the division,
yep,
and then got eliminated in the first round, and then everything went back the next few years. I do see signs that maybe it's changing, just because the Dolphins do have some nice young talent at the core. You know, with the signing of Mike Wallace, I thought it was a good move. You see a guy like Charles Clay. Hopefully, Sean Moreno gets healthy soon. There's a couple of pieces now that brought to the offensive line. Defensively, you know, you've got guys like Vernon and Wake and Audric that have played well. Brent Grimes is a great move. So there are pieces there. But I still think, to be honest with you, man, that this is the same type of Dolphins team. I'm not jumping on some bandwagon that this is a 10-6, 11-5, 12-4 team. I mean, I think we're looking at an 8-8, 9-7 team that could still make the playoffs, though, because of the struggling AFC East.
Talking about struggling divisions and conferences and teams, oh, boy, am I going to get killed for saying that. The Miami Hurricanes, big win against Duke. They go in tonight to Georgia Tech, a little hostile environment. They haven't done well in road games during the Al Golden era. They are 3-2. The bright side is that division obviously up for grabs, because those two losses may be inconsequential in that Coastal Division race. Your thoughts on this team, what they showed us last week, and what's in store, not just for tonight, but the remainder of the season. Brad Kaya developing wonderfully. Can the defense hold up their end of the bargain and make this team a contender in the ACC Coastal?
Well, here's the thing. I got to put on two hats on this one. Number one is my work hat, which, you know, for working on a TV station or whatever and trying to cover a team. And number two is my fan hat. And, you know, for my fan hat, let's start with that, because I think, you know, we're fans and above all, you know, love them. And it's like I love the school and I want to see the program do well. When I put my fan hat on entering the season, the only thing I cared about, honestly, was obviously I wanted the team to win. But I wasn't sitting there thinking, like, this is a 10-11 win team. This is a team that's going to knock down the ACC, have a chance against Florida State. I wanted to see, once Golden made the decision, which I thought was the right decision when he made it, and obviously now it's definitely been the right decision, to go with the true freshman in Brad Kaya. Because in a true freshman season, you really have to just expect some lumps, some ups and downs. But what you want to see is growth. So as a fan, I know they're 3-2. I know fans who are probably listening are thinking, you know, that's a loser's mentality. I am happy with the way things have gone, because I have seen that they have a quarterback that I truly believe could be the guy for the next 3-4 years. So when I see that, I think to myself, all else is gravy. They keep playing well, winning some games, great. But I'm happy because I think they finally found the quarterback, and I think they've got some pieces obviously around them that can help them develop even more. All right, let's put the, you know, work hat on and covering the team. Yeah, this is a big year for them, and they need to win these games. And that Duke win was impressive, but this one's just as important, because in year four of Al Golden, it's time, man. They haven't been to that ACC title game yet. The Coastal is up for grabs. There is no dominant team. But sort of like the Dolphins, we have seen this story before. We've seen this team that wins a game, you say, yay, and then loses to a Wake Forest or a Georgia Tech, or, you know what I mean, I'm just throwing a middle-of-the-pack ACC team, and then brings you back down to reality. So I need to see consistency coming forward. It would not surprise me if they lose tonight, and tomorrow if we're having this conversation, we're having, oh, what the heck is wrong with the Kings and Al Golden and all this stuff. And that's unfortunately what we've seen from this team the last few years.
Will, man, I appreciate you coming on with us this morning. I know you just finished breakfast with the fam. I'm going to let you go. Before I do, where were you when Jeter went the other way in his final at-bat in Yankee Stadium?
Where was I? I was sitting on my couch, just sitting there going, man. Because, you know, the Giants were on the same time. I'm a big Giants fan. I was sitting there, and I was monitoring the game on my iPad. And then when it came on, I said, okay, I've got to watch this on TV on the big screen. And just sitting there like everyone else, just thinking, okay, this is going to happen. It couldn't have been any more fitting. You know, I had a quick story about Jeter. My first television job was in Montana. My second one was in Kalamazoo, Michigan, in Battle Creek, Michigan, where Derek Jeter is from. And so I lived there for a year, and it was in Jeter's second or third year in the big leagues. He held a charity event there and came back. And I remember seeing him as a young kid, and I remember that fresh face, just, you know, such a nice man. So I've been so excited. And he was only a few years removed from being a high school kid there in Kalamazoo, Battle Creek. And never in my wildest dreams would I think, you know, 20 years later, he would be a Yankees icon. And as good as he was even 2-3 years in, no one thought he was going to be in that same breath as far as important Yankees, like the great Yankees that have had the numbers retired. But there's no doubt he's the next one to have that number retired because he's an all-time great.
It was, you know, with all the things that we've done, and obviously you've been in media, at least deeper in media than I have. I've done radio 10 years now, and you know, I've done some writing for the Herald, and I've covered some things and seen some things. And you know that over the years you get a little desensitized from the impact, the fan impact of sports. I've never attended anything in sports. This includes the Heat's championships. I've never attended anything in sports that brought the reaction and the emotions that watching that hit from Yankee Stadium, holding my son in my arms, brought out that night. I don't, you know, Hollywood couldn't have written that better. And I think that the game is going to miss a guy like Jeter. I hope it's Trout because I like that guy. Or I hope even better that it's Stanton because we got him here. And if we don't get him here, I'm sure the Yankees will scoop him up. But either way, I thought it was great for baseball and it was a great springboard into the playoffs. Because honestly, this has been the best week in baseball in a long, long time. And I'm happy for the game because we both grew up watching it. We both grew up loving it. And it's a part of our lives as Cuban Americans. I'm thrilled and can't wait for 5:37 today, you know, as some baseball gets going. And yes, I will watch the Canes tonight, of course. But I want to see that Giants-Nationals game this afternoon.
Same here, man. I'll be watching. It'll be fun. Hopefully this keeps on going.
You're the man, Will Mantle, our best available Cuban, our favorite Cuban here on the Amigo Show. Appreciate your time, brother.
You got it, brother. Anytime.
Take care. Love having him on, dude. Love having that guy on. 954-990-0036. What we're going to do is we're going to take a short break. We'll come back. We'll get to your calls. I haven't had a chance to answer some calls. I know a couple have come in. Give us a call, 954-990-0036, the Amigo Show on SoFlo Radio till 12 o'clock today. A little later in the show, in this hour, we'll have Melvin Bratton talking some Canes football with us later in this 10 o'clock hour. We'll also, in the 11 o'clock hour, have Jim Leyritz talk some Major League Baseball. And Kenny Anderson going to come on and give me some crap about the Georgia Tech-UM game and talk a little NBA basketball. You're listening to the Amigo Show right here on SoFloRadio.com.
You're listening to SoFloRadio.com.
At the Miami Princess Hotel, you are free to unlock the secrets of your imagination in one of our 8 exotic theme rooms, each designed to enhance your pleasure and provide a one-of-a-kind getaway experience with your loved one. A unique and treasured retreat nestled in the heart of the city, close to I-95 and the airport in Miami at 4251 Northwest 11th Street. Miami Princess Hotel provides theme rooms with 45-inch TVs, state-of-the-art sound systems, and jacuzzis. Give them a call, 305-441-1862.
By the Glass.
By the Glass is a show about beverage culture.
Brad Hubbard.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to connect the dots on how everything works together. It's really all about how we enjoy things, how we enjoy life, and how beverages play a big part in that. I'm going to bring in people that are going to display their aspect of the culture. I'm going to bring in people that are going to show you different products. We're going to look at places where people go to consume these beverages and how they all interact. Things are built around the actual beverage itself.
By the Glass. Thursdays from 6 to 7. Only on SoFlo Radio.
Say, remember when radio was fun?
Now it's dead.
Because deregulation has allowed one massive corporation to spread its tentacles like a giant octopus, absorbing radio stations around the globe. And that's why you hear this.
SoFlo Radio will stand and fight the corporate monolith. SoFloRadio.com. SoFloRadio.com.
All systems are functional.
And you pass the reins to Mr. Jackal, the new king of radio.
Is there life on other planets?
This is nuclear physicist Stanton Friedman, and now I'm a voice in the Jackal's head.
Is the government keeping secrets from us?
This is Stephen Bassett, and I am now a voice inside the Jackal's head.
Want to find out more? Listen to the Jackal's Head on the Super Media Network.
The biggest trick the Jackal ever pulled was to convince the world that he doesn't exist.
You are listening to The Amigo Show with Larry, the Amigo Million.
Larry, 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 the Million. You are so old, you are so old.
On SoFloRadio.com.
Yeah, baby, yeah. Woo! Back again,
that's right.
Luda.
Feel this.
This gets meaner and meaner each time, baby. Feel it a bull in this industry, man. Some would rather run down and get one cow.
My laptop sucks.
Down and get them all. You know what
it never works. We go through the same thing every show with this laptop.
Every single show. My music sticks in fans' veins like
an IV flow. Good like song choice, by the way.
Thank you.
I usually rag on you about your song choices. I'll tell you, hey, man, I trust you. Go with your... You play a song and then I rag on you on the air about it.
No, you go, anything you want. I don't care. And then you start playing your sound effects.
So we got some new buttons. I haven't been using the buttons.
Bruh.
Well, there's some good ones. There's a new one
that fits the song, actually.
How about new?
There's one with a bad word that I would be doing a Jameis Winston, so I can't use that one for sure. You remember that one?
Yeah, I didn't remember that. I was playing with that one the other day.
I like that. All right. 954-990-0036. You know, everybody at work told me they were going to listen. So I've texted everybody at work. Like the other day, we go into this huge meeting, right? So the vice president, where's Larry? I'm right here. Is it true you're still doing like radio on the weekends? I said, internet radio, SoFloRadio.com, The Amigo Show. Oh, we got to all listen. You guys can call in whenever you want. I think I've told this to you before. They know one side of me. This, they're not used to this. They know I'm a little zany. And yesterday I took Zany out and brought him out, took him for a walk around the park. We had some event at work. Not an event. We had a training at work. And they told us we could dress down. So I said I could either come in a thong, which would be a sight for sore eyes.
Oh, my.
Or I could wear my Jeter jersey. So I wore my Jeter jersey. And I wore like 8 different hats. I had a fedora. I had a Yankee Scully.
Oh, my God.
I wore my regular Yankee hat. I wore my Benny Blanco from the Bronx white Yankee hat. Another Nike hat that just says New York. Looks like a road. You know how the road New York says? It has that. I wore my Jeter helmet as well. And
how many heads do you have?
I own roughly about 250 hats.
Oh, my God.
Different teams, different things. I probably have 16 Yankee hats. I think I have about 18 or 20 Canes hats. Like, it's just... So, yesterday, one of the guys at work, you know, obviously when I'm changing hats, he looks at my head, he goes, dude, please tell me you didn't get that haircut to look like Derek Jeter. I said, yes, I did. If you're watching us on the Ustream, you can tell that I have a lot less hair than I used to. Remember, I went from bald to saying I have to have a full head of hair. I'm talking to CFOs now. Mm-hmm. I'm an executive sales dude now. You know, I'm a career man. I wear a suit and tie every day. We got it. And then I started looking like that guy that I used to make fun of, you know, with the flap over. Like, I'm follically challenged. We know this. You know, like, you too, by the way.
Yes.
But whatever.
Yes, I
want to make fun of you. But
that's why I always have a hat on.
I'm going to talk about follicles. I mean, you can relate to being follically challenged.
If I didn't have a hat on, like, the whoever's watching online would be blinded by the shine of light that bounces off my forehead.
So needless to say, the other day I looked at myself in the mirror, right? And I said, no, this is ridiculous. This looks hideous. I'm shaving it all off. So I didn't want to go the Kojak look. So, you know, I said, what's the next best thing? Let's look like the man, the myth, Mr. Derek Jeter. 954-990-0036. Thank Will Mansell for joining us on the show. Later this hour, we'll get Melvin Bratton on the phone, talk little Canes. So I'm going to switch gears temporarily to the NFL. Something we haven't talked a lot about. Will made a funny comment about the Dolphins, 8-8, 9-7. I've heard that before. Like, it's almost like a broken record. Heard that before. Like, why is it that the Dolphins can't get out of that 8-8, 9-7 zone? It's a 7-9, 8-8, 9-7 zone. Because outside of that Sperano year, where they went 11-5, that's pretty much been the last 10 years the way it is.
Yeah, it's been it's like putting the same movie on over and over and over and over and over again.
Okay, so I just get a text from my boss, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a little surprised because I think my boss is the coolest. She's a rock star in my eyes. And this either is because her fiance is one or she is one. And I need to find out urgently. And I hope this doesn't affect our work relationship. But she says, I'm trying to tune in. I'll try to tune in soon. Heading to Pompano to a bar to watch the Gator game.
Oh, you need to be careful what you say. You need to be careful.
So she is
like a boss,
but for right now, she gets going to watch a Gator game. You can't get those 3.5 hours of your life back. You can't do that, boss. You worked long and hard this week. Like, invest your time in something better than that. All right, so you see people at work are starting to come out of the woodworks. My boy Pierce is listening right now. Smell you later, Pierce. 954-990-0036. So the NFL is just, like, I think this is a product of that salary cap. I think it's a product of there's a lot of parity in the NFL. Like, you have your teams that stand out, and then you have teams like the Dolphins that are never going to get out of that 500 zone. Like, what promise does this team deliver to any Dolphin fan or anyone in thinking that they can be better than 8-8 or 9-7? That's this time last year, having the same conversation.
Yep.
This time 2 years ago, having the same conversation. And if it's not that they start at 0-6 and then, you know, come back to make it 7-9. They start off good and then tail off. It's always 7-9, 8-8, 9-7. If you can't get out of that zone, you're not going to do anything in the NFL.
No.
So I see them in London last week just tear through the Raiders, only to find out later the Raiders got to London 4 days early. That explains it. You ever gone to Vegas?
I was going to say, why? I mean, it's London. It's not Vegas.
Well, but you gone to Vegas?
Yeah, yeah.
What happens after the third day? You start getting run down.
Yeah.
You start getting tired, difference in time.
But that has to do with a lot of partying and drinking. And
you don't think they... What did they go to London for 4 days early for? To see
adapt
the sights?
No, adapt to the time?
My ass. Adapt to nothing.
Dolphins left Friday, London, right?
Yeah, they've been there before. By the way, London's like a home game for them. Yeah. So many Dolphin fans in London. Yeah. Maron, are you kidding me?
They say that that's one of the most supported teams in London.
No, the most supported team in London. Armando Salguero, when I used to do a show with Mondo, he used to talk about it all the time, that it was a pleasure to go there because it was loaded with Dolphin fans. In fact, we made jokes that there's probably more Dolphin fans in London than there are in Miami.
Probably. I mean, Joe Rose was saying that there was a lot of Merino jerseys. So
they're
old
school,
old school
Dolphin
old school fans.
Absolutely. And I mean, they are local about their Dolphins over there. So it's fun to see that dynamic. But getting back to the point of my question is 7-9, 8-8, 9-7. That gets old. What do you do to get out of that rut? What is it that you can... There's signs of progress with the running game. There's signs of progress with some of the things that they do. But all in all, like, we're going back to that again this year. And with all due respect, everything that happened with Tannehill before the game, is he starting? Is he not starting? All that crap. Did that help him? I think it helped him that he was playing an easy defense.
Yeah, because they traveled across the ocean to find out that they were playing a team that was worse than them.
Yeah.
That's it. That's pretty much what it is.
They rolled them.
I mean, okay, he was more accurate than he's been. Okay, so he had a good game. But the Raiders aren't a great team, and a lot of the Dolphin fans are drinking the Kool-Aid.
Oh,
you know?
I'm not.
I'm not either. Like, I'm done being tricked. This is like being teased over and over and over again. It's like having that pretty girl that you're going after, and she makes you do whatever she wants you to do, just to find out that you ain't getting any.
But that's fine, because the reality is going to settle in next Sunday.
Yeah.
That Lacy that went 13 carries, 105 yards on Thursday night, he's going to have 10 days of rest, right, before playing the Dolphins. Well, the Dolphins, they had a bye week. They have 14 days rest. Yeah, but
Aaron Rodgers.
Aaron Rodgers, good luck. I wish you the best of luck with that one. I don't know, man. I can't get my hands around it. I mean, Lamar Miller's been a pleasant surprise this year.
He's been running better. I think he's been getting some good, What is motivation, coaching from Noshan?
He's been getting good holes.
But he's been running harder. Yards a carry. He's not a hardcore runner the way he's been running this year. He's more finesse. And that's what we've seen in Killian. We saw that at the U. We did saw that and the first couple years in the Miami. And we're not seeing that type of running from Lamar Miller right now.
My math is off. It's 5.5 yards a carry right now. And he's on 1,000-yard pace, by the way. But so is Eddie Lacy.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to be an interesting game to see. It's not an AFC East game, but this is not like college football. You got to win every game you play. But it's still going to be one of those games you're playing against a different style of football team with a smart quarterback with a lot of strong quarterback acumen. The guy's, you know, he's excellent at his position. And the Dolphins, like, to get out of this rut, they need to get on a roll. And then the same way Alonzo was talking about how UM has to beat some good teams, like, Miami has to beat some good teams. We thought they did that when they beat the Patriots. And as you can tell, the Patriots, who knows what they are this year. Doesn't look very good, though. Doesn't look very good. So the Packers next Sunday here at Sun Life. Maybe that's a springboard to better things. I'm always thinking the glass is half full. But goodness gracious, 7-9, 8-8, 9-7 zone. That zone right there, that belongs to the Dolphins the last 15 years. It's pathetic. 954-990-0036. I'm going to jump to a break. When we come back from break, we'll get Melvin Bratton, former UM great, on the telephone, talk a little bit about the Canes against Georgia Tech tonight. Remember, later in the show, we'll get Jim Larritz to talk some baseball, Major League Baseball playoffs. Kenny Anderson talk a little NBA. I still haven't given Colin the business. Like, if Colin listens to my show, like I must think I'm really big time or something. Colin does not listen to my show. He doesn't even answer my tweets. $1,000, Colin. That's a drop in the bucket for you. That's a lot of money for me. The Heat can win 40 games. The Heat will win 40 games this year, even though you don't think they will. But before we do that, when we come back from break, we'll get Melvin Bratton on the phone, talk a little Canes football right here on The Amigo Show, SoFloRadio.com.
You're listening to SoFloRadio.com.
At the Miami Princess Hotel, you are free to unlock the secrets of your imagination in one of our 8 exotic theme rooms, each designed to enhance your pleasure and provide a one-of-a-kind getaway experience with your loved one. A unique and treasured retreat nestled in the heart of the city, close to I-95 and the airport in Miami at 4251 Northwest 11th Street. Miami Princess Hotel provides theme rooms with 45-inch TVs, state-of-the-art sound systems, and jacuzzis. Give them a call, 305-441-1862.
By the Glass.
By the Glass is a show about beverage culture.
Brad Hubbard.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to connect the dots on how everything works together. It's really all about how we enjoy things, how we enjoy life, and how beverages play a big part in that. I'm going to bring in people that are going to display their aspect of the culture. I'm going to bring in people that are going to show you different products. We're going to look at places where people go to consume these beverages and how they all interact. Things are built around the actual beverage itself.
By the Glass. Thursdays from 6 to 7. Only on SoFlo Radio.
The Owen Frank Noodle Show.
So how do people actually do it, males, in the region?
Dude,
that's if you say you have that much pain on your arm and legs, that's unacceptable. At that point, something's going on.
I don't go to that level, though. I trim with a little machine, bro.
You know, buzzer?
A little buzzer. Buzz down there, a little manscape, and we're good to go. Hey, bro, you got a manscape nowadays. No chick wants to go down there and, you know what I'm saying, feel hairs.
No, that's terrible. Neither do we, so you got, it goes both ways,
it
right?
It goes both ways, brother. You know what I'm saying? Some chicks go down there, you got hair, and they're like, whoa, wait, let me come back up.
Hold on, cowboy.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The Owen Frank Noodle Show, Tuesday evenings from 6 to 8 p.m. only on SoFloRadio.com.
All systems are functional.
And you pass the reins to Mr. Jackal. King of radio.
Is there life on other planets?
This is nuclear physicist Stanton Friedman, and now I'm a voice in the Jackal's head.
Is the government keeping secrets from us?
This is Stephen Bassett, and I am now a voice inside the Jackal's head.
Want to find out more? Listen to the Jackal's head on the Super Media Network.
The biggest trick the Jackal ever pulled was to convince the world that he doesn't exist.
You are listening to The Amigo Show. With Larry, the Amigo Million.
Hold that plane!
Sure. You can't go in there!
On SoFloRadio.com.
It's okay! I'm a limo driver!
two, three into the four. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the dope, ready to make an entrance.
Good, good selection of music today. You're doing a good job because I love this song. Oh, man. The Amigo Show right here on SoFloRadio.com. My next guest. Man, you talk about having old friends come on the show. We had Zoe on in the 9 o'clock hour. That was fun. Our next guest is another University of Miami Hurricane great. And whenever it's time to talk some Canes football, he's one of the best to talk to. Like when we hang up with him, Frank, we're going to want to line up and play tonight. Like, that's kind of what comes from this, because he's old school Canes. Funny, my son, yet to meet Melvin, right? But my son's enamored, like I said to Alonzo, documentary The U. And he just thinks that Alonzo and Melvin are just it. Like, he'll go to school and talk to kids about you, and my dad is friends with, and those kids don't know what the hell he's talking about. Son watches that movie once a week. His favorite part is when Bratton's telling the story, when Mel's telling the story about 2 o'clock in the morning in the hotel room, and they pick up the phone and they call Fontainebleau Hilton.
Bad boys, come on and play.
Jamel. Come on. And they call Bosworth, right? And said they're going to do everything to him. And Zoe's going crazy in the background, throwing things. Like, my son, he'll rewind to it just to watch that part because he laughs. That, and when Randall Hill did the guns. And
of course, running through the tunnel.
He loves that. And
my favorite part in the movie actually comes from Mel's mouth when he goes, all the girls get to see the basketball players' faces. I want to take my helmet off so they see my face too. Badass.
So, let's not waste any time. No. Melvin Bratton joins us here on the Amigo Show on SoFloRadio.com. What's up, Mel?
What up, amigos?
How you doing, kid? How's everything going?
Hey, man, what's going on? But y'all turn that music down, man. What, y'all got a concert going on over there, bro?
You know how it is with me, bro. It's all about the music and the sports, man. We turned it down for you, man. No more concert. How you doing, bro?
Man, you know I'm older, man. I can't take all that Jeep thing and everybody talking about smoking out and stuff like that, man. I'm getting old, bro.
We're not that old yet, Mel. I think, yeah. Coach could get a dozen plays out of you if we needed it tonight, right?
Say it again?
I think Coach could get a dozen carries out of you tonight if we needed you to run the ball tonight, no?
You are. I can't. I'm sorry. I got a bad connection. What did you say, bro?
I think Coach Golden could get a dozen carries out of you tonight if we needed you to run the football against Georgia Tech.
Hey, bro, I went to the kickoff thing last night, the pep rally, and a guy came to me last night and said the same thing. Bro, I got a half a snap in me left, bro. One, a half a snap. Just put me on goal line, bro. Goal line, one play, and I can't go over the top anymore, but I'll probably run through somebody and probably get – I might fumble the ball, bro.
So no 5-touchdown games for you anymore, huh?
No, man, I'm out of gas, bro. I'm out of gas.
Mel, talk to me a little bit about what you think about tonight's game. Obviously, you know, Georgia Tech, even though we've had our way with them the last few years, the truth is the triple option always – kind of brings a little bit of a challenge to defenses. Miami's done traditionally a very good job against the triple option, but the twist, the fact that they're playing in a hostile environment, you've been at Bobby Dodd before. Your thoughts on tonight's game and what Miami's going to need to do to kind of take advantage and take the crowd out of the game and come back home with a win?
Well, I mean, I'll be at the game tonight. Me and my son, we headed out there tonight with some friends. And the thing is, right now, this is going to be a test for a lot of the young guys, the D-line. Everybody got to be gap control. One of the things is the options, you got to be very, very disciplined. That's why we had success under Jimmy Johnson and Stellenberger, because you got to have your – make sure that everybody has to have their band. If one guy make one mistake, they can hit us with like a long run and a touchdown. So you got to be very, very disciplined to make sure that you just use your keys. So this right now tonight is going to show Paramus should have the best game of his life. I was telling somebody last night, he should have the best game of his life because this is the type of game that he loves to go downhill and smash blocks and football. So it should be exciting. This kid should have like 20 times tonight. So I'm looking forward to the team. And it's going to really show us as fans to see how tough our team is as far as, you know, physically, because you can't go in there and be a finesse type deal and a lot of what happened at the basket, do the same thing here, because these guys, they were gashing. And these kids are going to play real hard against us.
Mel, you know, the other thing that, like, as the season started, they went with Brad Kaya over Heaps, and I wasn't sure who would be better. I thought maybe you go with the guy who had a few years of college football under his belt. Obviously, what the heck do I know? Kaya has been developing nicely. You can tell he's got that presence under center in the pocket. He's still making some freshman mistakes, but boy, does he have a gun. Your thoughts on his role in tonight's game in what I think is a superior offense, because I think we've got the talent at the wide receiver. We've got great running back in Duke Johnson. Obviously, Joseph Yerby is off the chain as well. Your thoughts on how that's going to relay into the remainder of the season for them, but more importantly, tonight in a game against a team that likes the ball control, likes to chop away, and likes to keep the opposing offense off the field.
Well, you know what? The thing is that the young kid, Kaya, I mean, when the first game, everybody was kind of going being erratic and what are we doing? But, you know, people have to have a give a chance. Like Bernie Kuzar was one of the kids, you know, saying that he was two freshmen, a redshirt guy that got an opportunity. Everybody didn't know who the heck he was, and look where his career ended up. So this kid here shows a lot of poise. I like it. He makes some mistakes, but that's part of growing pains. But when we look, the future looks great with this kid right here. I mean, for the next few years, we got us a star. I mean, this is going to be one of the top quarterbacks in the country because he learned from his mistakes. One of the things that we got to be more aggressive on offense. I say attack the ball downfield like they did last week. Diego Coley is a great guy, great coach. But, dude, let's go with it. I mean, the run is going to start the pass. So play action, smash route, pull it, and let's go up top. You got to respect it. I mean, mix it up, man. I mean, the thing is, you got to go at different styles. Because these guys really, kids like Georgia Tech here is going to play way over their head. Everybody gets pumped up because there's Miami coming in. They don't understand. Kids going to play two more notches than they normally play against a Duke or whoever coming in. So this is the game right now. They just say as when they retire and later on when they double school, I kicked Miami butt, you know what I'm saying, when they came here or whatever. People look to get points off us. Now, I still got guys coming to me, oh, yeah, hey, I remember you got knocked out by Jarvis, you know, Williams, you know, at Florida. So people still hold on to these memories. So we can't give them memories, man, and go ahead and talk about it.
And you know what's funny? We were talking to Alonzo about that earlier in the show, Melvin Bratton joining us here on the Amigo Show. And I'm astonished that even though, you know, I don't want to allude to the fact that the last few years haven't been good because there's been promise with UM, but certainly it's not like the 80s or the 90s. I'm surprised when we go on the road that it's the other team's Sugar Bowl. It's the other team's national championship. It's the other team's Super Bowl, to maybe use a bad comparison, but to try to make the point. Like, I'm surprised that so many years later from being that top team in the country, that top program in the country, that programs and kids that weren't even alive when we were doing it to them, gun and circle their calendar for that big Canes game, and programs take and say, you know what, we're going to make this a Thursday night, or we're going to make this a night game instead of a day game because this is what we want. I'm still surprised that the bullseye is still on the Hurricanes' back after so many years.
Bro, you got to realize, I forget what team we played in the bowl game a couple years. I don't know if it was Louisville or whatever, but these guys actually, I had talked to one of the coaches, and they said they put, instead of going to the movies, most teams go to the movies a night before the game, they'll go see the latest movies, the captains will pick a team, pick a movie. I forgot, I think it was Louisville or somebody we played, we lost that bad game in a Citrus Bowl or somewhere in Florida some years ago. These guys said they watched the U documentary. So what the coaches did, they used the U documentary of the old to kind of get into their head and say, these are the type of guys that you're playing. Don't go out here and get embarrassed. So one of the kids, the coach told me, man, we got so pumped up watching the U. So they took the mentality that we had back then and applied it to us. So I was like, wow. That was a good strategy on the coach's part because we got our butt kicked that time. But, you know, everywhere we go, regardless, we made it bad for these kids. But, hell, don't come to Miami if you don't want to be that guy. You don't want to feel like you're a big playmaker. So everybody got to step up and say, look, I want the ball. I want to be the guy to make that big play. And that's what I don't see all the time, consistency. So my thing is we all just got to step up, not to panic. And Gordon's a good guy. He's going to get his turnaround. So don't everybody try to throw him off the bus right now. I like the dude. He's going to be okay. So I support it, man. We just got to give some time to get these babies to grow up. And let's go to work, man. Like I said, we got to go and start running the ball, smash my ball.
Melvin Bratton joining us here on the Amigo Show on SoFloRadio.com. I've been impressed with Kaya. I've been impressed with Duke Johnson. He rushed for over 100 last week against Duke in a victory. He's got 525 yards and 4 touchdowns for the season. I've been incredibly impressed with Philip Dorsett. Not a lot of receptions, but he's a deep threat. I've not been impressed with a kid like Stacy Coley, who showed so much promise last year. This year, he's a little off. I've also continued to not be impressed with the defense. And even though I saw some progress last week, I didn't get to see the whole game. I was on a plane, but certainly saw pieces of it at the end and saw bits and pieces on replay. The defense, in my opinion, needs to do more and needs to be more aggressive to help this offense flourish and to help this offense score. Your thoughts on the defense and the direction that it's going in and what you think you would change if you were the defensive coordinator?
Well, you know what? I agree with you on the defense. And my thing is, we're not that bend don't break type mentality. We had that when we first came to Miami, and that's when Kostellberger, because you know when you don't have those type athletic kids, you do that because you don't get yourself in a bad position. You know, so that mentality has to go because we have like athletes and playmakers. So don't give me that gap control, stay your man, whatever. We need to blitz, sit here from the corner. I mean, do all the things that mix this thing up because we're too predictable, you know. So I am totally agreeing with you. We're too much laid back, and that gets us – these guys are not as big. We don't have a lot of big, big guys, especially in front. So you can't sit there and play that gap control type deal and try to make plays based on you go there, and the guys are going to be there. No, we got to mix it up. We got a lot of gaming, a lot of stunts, a lot of blitzes. Take chances, man. Take some shots, man. I mean, that's the only way you're going to mix it up. There's these kids – last week, when I was watching the game, and I called somebody, I said, you know what? This was the first time I've seen these kids at University of Duke have fun. They would bounce around, high-fiving, dancing in between the commercials and the timeouts, and they come back in. I'm looking like, see, that's the attitude. Turn these kids loose. You cannot put a chokehold on them, allow them to have fun. And that's what brings other kids want to come to Miami. The simple fact that, like, look, man, these guys, they control them off the field, but they have a fun on the field. And this was the first game last week versus Duke that I've seen these kids just relax and have fun. So we need to get back to it, man, and stop trying to put on this pressure. Stop trying to make something that's not there. Turn these kids loose. Have fun. And I promise you, the results, man, we can run the table from there.
Melvin, I've been pretty adamant about what you just said in reference to the defense going out there and having fun. I've noticed that many times the lack of aggressive play, playing on their heels opposed to playing on the balls of their feet. You know, I think there's a huge difference in how you react to a ball and how you hit someone if you're regressing opposed to being on the balls of your feet. And I always say the same thing. Some people ask me what I mean by that. But I think that in order to maximize this talent that we supposedly recruit year in, year out, you've got to implement some of that stuff to bring that out in these kids. True or false, these kids grow up playing Pop Warner, then they play high school, and the reason they're the more talented players is because they have the instincts to play the game. I don't depend on them to call a defense. I don't depend on them to structure a game plan. I understand that that's not on their job description, but I do depend on them to use that talent and to use that football acumen on the field to make those plays. And I do depend on the coaches to put them in those positions to do so. After last week, do you think that was just an adjustment for Duke, or do you think that this is something we're going to see from this team for the rest of the season?
That's a good question. Somebody asked me that, you know, but this game plan here we can't gamble now. This tonight, we got to be gap control. So we got to go back to that theory, making sure everybody hit the gap to make that play. Because if you get out of place one time here, it could be a 60-yard touchdown automatically. And the thing is, too, they have a system where they can mix it up to the point where you keep coming up as a corner. And guess what? They're going to pull the trigger and they're going to go up top. So it's just like I said, they got to be very disciplined tonight. But I think that what we saw a little promise last week versus Duke, I think they're going to go back to that. I mean, tonight you can't be that blitzer and try crazy stuff like that. You got to be very disciplined on this type of offense. I ran this offense in high school at Northwestern. Mm-hmm. So if one person makes a mistake, we will gas you. So they got to stay, you know, gap control tonight to go against what we're talking about in our principle. But when we come back out of this, now let's go back to that team and having fun. And we cannot allow to, when we go into other folks' backyard, like I said, back then, we didn't care about a away game. That's Showtime at Apollo. We know we're trying to come in there and take our girlfriends out of the stadium, bro. So we're going to play even harder. We're going to go come in there. We winking at the chicks, throwing kisses. Oh, come on. I mean, we want y'all girls. So going away was way more, you know what I'm saying, more exciting because we're trying to meet new chicks, bro.
Showtime at the Apollo. I sure hope your mouth to God's ears tonight that we put on a show over at Bobby Dodd Stadium in Atlanta. I know you're going to be there. When are you going to come back to Miami, man? I'd love to have you either in studio or the heck with that. We just go grab something to eat and talk about old times.
Yeah, let's do it, man. I come in the studio, got to take you some Cuban food, man. You know, I haven't had that up here, bro, so you got to take me. And I want to go in the hood, man. A little better, like the dirt road, man. Somewhere in the back, man, where you got to walk to the back door where it's greasy.
Hialeah, baby. I'll take you to Hialeah. We can go La Sauceda. Either way, I'll get you a big old plate of Cuban food, and we'll hang out and talk about old times. An old friend of the program, UM legend and great Melvin Bratton, I appreciate you coming on the show. Have fun at the game tonight. I know there's a whole bunch of UM fans out there. I know you saw some of them last night. You'll see a lot more tonight. But I know you'll be representing wearing the orange and green. I love you, man. Love you very much, and I appreciate you coming on the show today.
All right, bro. Tell my little nephew, man. I'm looking forward to meeting you, man. Appreciate the guys.
You'd be proud of the little guy, man. He thinks that you're a rock star. He thinks Zoe's a rock star. I was telling Zoe he watches the U documentary all the time, man. And he'll rewind to the two parts he likes is the coin toss of that game and you creating a ruckus in that hotel room, calling the Fountain Blue to go to Jamel, come out and play. He loves all that, man. He's a true Kane, and he's just 9 years old, but he's dying to meet you. So get your butt over to Miami, man. We'll have a family dinner. We'll do it the right way.
All right, man. Appreciate y'all, man. Thanks, guys. Good job.
Take care, man. Love you, bro.
I love you too, bro. Pete.
Take care. That is Melvin Bratton. You know, my friend, former producer of a previous show when I used to do with Diz, the Amigo and Diz, my boy Fabian, he always calls me the name dropper. But it's like, what can I say? That guy's really my friend from back in the day. I met him when he played at UM. Him and Zoe met him when they played at UM, and it's been a friendship ever since. Like, and I've stayed in touch with him for goodness gracious. It's going on 30 years. So it's kind of cool to say that those two are good friends of mine. I love having them on the program. But I love when Melvin starts talking about old Canes football. You see, Alonzo's a little more grounded. He's got that Green Bay Packers mentality. He does it with class, and it's all business.
He's matured a little bit, more professional.
Even though Alonzo will come off the cuff sometimes and go crazy on you. But Mel don't play. We're coming in here.
Yeah, I thought Mel was going to jump through my microphone and punch me in the freaking face.
Showtime at the Apollo. We came to take your chicks. Like, that's how Mel rolls, man. He talks about, I'm too old. That's a lot of fire right there. You got to love that. Folks, we come back from break, top of the hour, final hour here of the program, an hour in which we'll talk to Jim Leyritz. We'll also talk to Kenny Anderson, and we'll take your calls at 954-990-0036. By the way, my boss sent me a text back, Frank. So I got the skivvy on everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the reason she is going is because her fiancé is a Gator.
Oh, so she's not a Gator.
Yeah.
Okay. So she's
forgiven. I'm not going to be able... I want to rag on her, but I can't do that because, you know, she's...
So I take a lot of disinfectant, a lot of hand sanitizer.
I get a weird feeling that she roots for them because it's her man, bro. Like, come on now. You know, like, go Gators. No.
I can't understand. My friend is a Canes, all right? And he just got married to a Seminole. I never understood how that worked. Yeah. If I had to look at that logo all the time, I think I would go crazy.
By the way, I just got a text from Alonzo. He's going to be in town next week because obviously the Dolphins play Green Bay. So I got to take him for sure to Tony Roma. He loves Tony Roma's, boy. So, yeah. So I got that on the docket. Hopefully we get Melvin in town. And then I got to be nice to my boss because if not, you know, I get in trouble. So
you're listening to SoFloRadio.com.
Escape with your loved one to your own private fantasy world at the totally renovated Miami Princess Hotel, 4251 Northwest 11th Street, next to the airport in Miami. Unlock the secrets of your imagination in one of our 8 exotic theme rooms. Journey to the Orient in the Japanese room. Ancient delights await in the Roman room. Be the king of your jungle in the Tarzan room. Breathtaking suites designed to provide the utmost of intimacy. Miami Princess Hotel, located close to I-95 and the airport. Give them a call, 305-441-1862. That's 305-441-1862.
By the Glass.
By the Glass is a show about beverage culture.
Brad Hubbard.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to connect the dots on how everything works together. It's really all about how we enjoy things, how we enjoy life, and how beverages play a big part in that. I'm going to bring in people that are going to display their aspect of the culture. I'm going to bring in people that are going to show you different products. We're going to look at places where people go to consume these beverages and how they all interact. Things are built around the actual beverage itself.
By the Glass. Thursdays from 6 to 7. Only on SoFloRadio.com. SoFloRadio.com is the exclusive radio home of the Fort Lauderdale Strikers Football Club. Listen for every corner kick, penalty kick, save, and goal on SoFloRadio.com.
To Anderson, the save by, the save by Gorick, but the putback by Darnell King, and the Strikers are up 2-0.
Silverman on Sports host Bruce Silverman brings you the play-by-play.
SoFloRadio.com, bringing you every Striker home game.
Starting live at 7:30. SoFlo Radio. Talk, music, sports. SoFloRadio.com.
The Amigo Show with Larry Million.
Yeah, I said it. Michael Jordan was the biggest thing in the NBA. LeBron is the biggest thing in the NBA. Same type of star. I'm not going to argue who's better today. And you look at that, right, Frank? And I remember Jordan. Like, I rooted against Jordan. You know why I rooted against Jordan? Woo! My voice went soprano. Oh my goodness.
No, what I meant to say was when I do you know why I root against
you have failed.
That's what I was trying to say.
The Amigo Show, Saturday mornings from 9 to noon, only on SoFloRadio.com.
You are listening to The Amigo Show with Larry, the Amigo Million.
Water sucks. Gatorade is better. Gatorade not only quenches your thirst better, it tastes better too, idiot.
You're drinking the wrong water.
Gatorade.
H2O.
Gatorade.
H2O.
On SoFloRadio.com.
Water sucks. It really, really sucks.
Sucks. No,
it really, really sucks. You're bad people. Oh, man. Like that promo. Gatorade.
H2O. H2O.
The Amigo Show, final hour of the program. Want to give thanks to Melvin Bratton for juicing me up. Now I'll get to sleep about 5 in the morning because that's like drinking 12 Red Bulls. And he says he's old. Complaining about the loud music early and at the end of the thing, he's got us bouncing off the walls here. Folks, quick little programming update. Tonight, 7:30, right here on SoFloRadio.com, my boy Bruce Silverman does play-by-play for the Fort Lauderdale Strikers as they face the Carolina Railhawks here at... They're playing that game here, right? At
Lockhart.
At Lockhart, right?
Yeah.
All right, so they catch that game right here on SoFloRadio.com. Bruce Silverman with the play-by-play. He does a good job. Bruce is a great guy. Whenever Bruce wants to come in and argue sports with me, the door is open for him. I love that guy. 954-990-0036. Kenny may or may not come on. He's got to push a little later. He's in the middle of, you know what he does Saturday mornings is he teaches kids about basketball. Like, you know, he does one-on-one things with them and whatnot. So yeah, it did get the skivvy on everything. By the way, Alonzo and I are already making dinner plans for this week. I love it. This is great. This is fantastic. My son's probably stoked because I know he's listening.
You're the man, Anthony.
So you saw the pictures of Miss Tennessee, didn't you?
Amazing. She has those like big like Katy Perry eyes that just like bring you in.
And she's got, let me tell you, she's got, if you imagine how a girl from Tennessee would talk, y'all, like that, like she's got that southern drawl. And in pimp fashion, the little guy did his duty.
So how are you guys sitting down? Like, you guys were all like in the same row? Were they like two
rows? Well, the funny thing is she had two seats right by the dugout. Okay. Right? Her and her boyfriend sat by the dugout. Because since she works in the press and she knows people who play for the Houston Astros, you know, they have contacts. She has contacts. So they had those seats. But then we bought other seats in a different section. So Charlie's godfather, Mario, you know, sat with us. And him and I were heckling. And my son was there with Mario and Charlie and me. And she would come back and forth, as would Charlie, you know. And they would leave the seats, come back to come see us, whatever. And then at one point she took us down. We saw the last inning and a half right there next to the Houston dugout. But when she would come, she'd sit next to him and they'd start talking. And you'd see, it's like, can you imagine a grown guy like hitting on a girl and just talking to her and not really paying attention to everybody, you know, not being slobbering over her, but real cool cat, real whatever. He's just talking. They're talking sports and they're talking about their favorite teams and their least favorite teams. And then we get on the subway and in the subway, you know, seats, right? We go sit down and I'm thinking my son's going to sit next to me and I'm holding his hand and he pulls away and he goes and he sits next to her.
So where did Charlie sit next to you?
Yeah. He sat between Charlie and her.
You should have tapped Charlie in the leg and be like, you're in trouble.
That's kind of when I told him, I go, dude, what's going on here, bro? And then they're walking, like, right before we get to Grand Central Station, walking down and like they walked ahead of us and held hands and then she took them and she was a sweetheart with him. Honest to goodness, wow. Like I applaud Chelsea. Man, Chelsea, you were a doll with my son. You made it as memorable as what Jeter was. It was as cool because he felt like a grown-up because he was hanging out with adults. And he felt like, you know what, I made friends. And he felt like a big person, you know. And I thought that was like the coolest thing. Charlie was amazing with him. Mario, they were all, because they all engaged in conversation with him as if he wasn't 9, but like if he was 29. You know what I mean?
Right.
They never made him feel like he was a kid. So that was a cool experience for us indeed. So I know that the little guy's excited about seeing Alonzo. I know that for a fact. And certainly we're going to have a good time this week with him. But in this hour, we'll talk some baseball with Jim Leyrich. Right around, it's 11:15. We might push it to about 11:20 or so. Get Jimbo on the phone. Jimbo was in the building, Yankee Stadium, last Thursday night, as was I, as was the little amigo. So we'll talk a little bit about that game, that moment, what he represents to the franchise, the future of the Yankees right now that they've got absolutely no one except old people and Alex Rodriguez coming back next year. And then, of course, we'll talk a little bit about Major League Baseball playoffs with him as well. And then later in the hour, hopefully we can get, even if it's just 5 minutes, of Kenny Anderson to come on so he can defend his Yellow Jackets, talk a little bit of how I don't represent New York because he gives me a hard time every time. I think I'm doing a better job, Kenny. I think, you know, obviously, I think, you know, with the 3 trips to New York in 90 days, I think I've shown you that I've embraced my northern roots again. But certainly when it comes to college football, that ain't happening because I will be and always will be a Cane. 954-990-0036. By the way, I got the juice on the boss. So the boss's fiance is a Gator. Mm-hmm. That's why they're going over there. So, you know, I have to be nice because she is
like a boss.
She's like a boss, mm-hmm. You know. And you always got to be cool with your boss. And she's a cool boss, by the way. I give her thumbs up. She's a cool boss. But her selection of football teams, like, really, honestly.
How about new?
Yeah, I don't think so. Like this crap here? Yeah, right? Right?
Yeah, no.
How about new?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah. Just that's or if you go like then you go. So that one's for you, Steph. Sorry. Can't be a Gator, never will be a Gator.
The clapping chant.
God, I can't stand them. I can almost survive FSU even though they're pompous. these days since they can't seem to lose to anybody. Did you see that game against NC State?
Yes, I did. In the parking lot.
Like, wasn't it like 87 to 86 or something like crazy like that?
Mm-hmm.
Once he passed 50 points, it doesn't matter. Like they were down by 10. They won by 10.
Oh, my God. They were down by like 21 in the beginning
of the
game. They
were. I was getting to the airport when that was going on.
I was getting giddy. Started drinking a little more.
All right. So I'll share a true story before we get a Larry time. Back in the day, back in New York, my godfather, he used to coach a girls' softball team. Mm-hmm. My cousin played on the softball team. All these girls played. They were like a championship caliber softball team. I was some kind of ball player growing up. I really was pretty good. So one day we went to have a recreational game. Like he had a picnic. He would do it like once a year, and it was like a pickup game, and they'd have it at a park near their house in Jackson Heights. And we went one time, and if I believe I was already living in Miami, we made the trip to go hang out and spend the week with them or whatever. And part of the week was he kind of coordinated and had this game at that time so that I could play. So the girls' team would play against the boys. Well, every year this girls' team would win. So I get there, Mr. 13 or 14-year-old, thinking I'm a badass, you know. And so I go to my godfather, I go, who's the best player on the team? You know, he points at his third baseman. Third baseman's name is Joy. And he says, she's my Greg Nettles. Well, back in the day, Greg Nettles was a big deal in the Yankees. So there was two problems. One is I was a third baseman, so she ain't better than me.
Mm-hmm.
And two was, I don't care how good she is.
She's a girl.
She's a girl. She's a girl. So when the game gets started, my godfather's egging me on. He knows how to push my buttons. And he tells me, he goes, you can't get it past my third baseman. Now, I generally, not because it's, I mean, I would love to correlate Jeter and anything that I say. And obviously not because Jeter was a young lad when this was going on. But I've always liked to go the other, either up the middle or the other way. If I pull, I pull to try, you know, to hit one down the line longer.
You're lefty?
No, I'm a righty.
Oh, okay.
But the problem is I was punching Judy. So I really try not to go to left field much. I just like to go the other way. So my godfather egging me on that I couldn't get it past his third baseman. So in my head, I go, you know what? I'm going to give this one try. I'm going to roll one down the line, make her look bad, and then that's going to be the end of this conversation about this woman named Greg Nettles, because I've had enough of it. I don't want to hear this anymore. And then the other goal was wanted to win the game. So I come up to the plate, you know, and the hoopla, whatever, and I go down the line. And the vacuum cleaner comes up with some unbelievable play. From one knee, she comes up throwing and throws me out at first. Everybody, whoa, whoa. Okay, so I sort of giggled it off. I wasn't thrilled, right? But whatever, it was what it was. My next at bat, I come up. My godfather's just laughing, going, you might as well try again since you couldn't do it before. I go again, but instead of trying to go down the line, I try to go to her left. Vacuum clean up, comes up throwing one leg, throws me out. 0-2, 5-3, 5-3 on both occasions. At this point, everyone's laughing, right?
Uh-huh. Now I'm sure you're getting heated now.
Now I'm pissed.
Yeah.
So my third at bat, I come up, and I stand out, I look around, I see that I could go to right center and at least get a double, right? And then I look at third base, I stand in, I go, I'm going at her again.
Too tempting.
Dude, the chick dives down the line. And mind you, I would have got it past most guys. Dives down the line. Line drive. 5 unassisted. Gets me out.
Wow.
I threw the bat. I was pissed.
Did she tell you anything after the game?
She shook my hand. She was really cool.
Yeah.
Right? So my next at bat... I go opposite field for a single, so I don't go 0-4, right? I go 1-4, but the 3 times I went at her, she ate me up. 30 years, bro. 30 years I have not been able to live that down. Every so often, my godfather, my uncle, whatever, he will remind me, do you remember when Joy showed you who the better third baseman was, whatever? Oh, my goodness. I have never been able to live it down. Saturday before we leave, we go to... He doesn't live in Jackson Heights anymore, but they had a reunion game. Now, these girls that played as 12, 13, 14-year-olds are now adults.
Oh, wow.
Grown women, doctors, lawyers, yeah. And they had a reunion game. And ironically, I'm in town for this reunion game. My son goes. My son's excited because, you know, he wants to see my godfather. He loves my godfather. And, well, we were there. We're having a great time. Everybody's warming up. And my son goes, I want to hit. So immediately my godfather's telling everybody the story about when Joy's there. I take a picture with Joy. Joy happens to not remember.
Okay.
She doesn't remember this. Like, she goes, you know, I can't remember it. Of course, my godfather with the smart-ass line goes, of course you don't remember, Joy, because you should do that to everybody. So she really was an excellent third baseman. So my son comes up to hit. My son, you know, a little kid. You know, he doesn't play much, whatever, but he's hearing this story, right? And even though it's comical to everyone, it's not comical to him because it made his dad look bad.
Right.
So he keeps telling me, Dad, I want to hit. Dad, I want to hit. I want to hit the ball to her. I'm like, Puppy, you know, let the girls play. Like, they're just having a reunion. So my godfather insists that my son hit. My son gets the bat, takes a couple of practice swings. He goes, okay, I'm ready, whatever. So they throw the pitch, right? And the kid rips one down the line.
Sucks it up.
Gets by Joy.
Oh, no.
He digs it out, base it, takes the turn at first. When he gets back at first, he points at me like Jeter. Like, you see Jeter do on replay so many times. The place is roaring. Everybody's hysterical laughing. My godfather, look what you couldn't do, your son did.
You were like this, like hanging your head low.
I was proud of him. Okay, I was very proud of him. She played him in and off the line, and he went down the line and got by her. It wasn't a line drive or anything, but it got by her. And what a great, cool little moment. Like I said, the entire trip was just, what a bonding thing. We walked the streets of New York till 1:30 both nights. We were just dudes. I actually explained to him, what I've done with you would have been the same thing I would have done with your godfather. I would have gone out, hung out, gone to grab pizza at 1 o'clock in the morning, like just done adult things. That's mm-hmm. I didn't treat it like a kid and put him in bed at 10 o'clock. Like, we went and did adult things. And I think that that's where he got the most out of the entire experience. That was a story I wanted to share as well. But of course, you know, I'm proud of him. And then about 2 minutes later, it dawns on me, I'm never going to live this down either. Oh, my godfather started, at least your son's a better hitter than you. Like, oh. 954-990-0036. Talking about good hitters. When we come back from break, Jimmy Leyritz, Yankee. He's a part of the lore of the New York Yankees. Definitely legendary status with clutch home runs. We'll talk about Captain Clutch, his exit from Yankee Stadium, Major League Baseball playoffs, and so much more on the Amigo Show right here on SoFloRadio.com.
You're listening to SoFloRadio.com.
Escape with your loved one to your own private fantasy world at the totally renovated Miami Princess Hotel, 4251 Northwest 11th Street, next to the airport in Miami. Unlock the secrets of your imagination in one of our 8 exotic theme rooms. Journey to the Orient in the Japanese room. Ancient delights await in the Roman room. Be the king of your jungle in the Tarzan room. Breathtaking suites designed to provide the utmost of intimacy. Miami Princess Hotel, located close to I-95 and the airport. Give them a call, 305-441-1862. That's 305-441-1862.
By the Glass.
By the Glass is a show about beverage culture.
Brad Hubbard.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to connect the dots on how everything works together. It's really all about how we enjoy things, how we enjoy life, and how beverages play a big part in that. I'm going to bring in people that are going to display their aspect of the culture. I'm going to bring in people that are going to show you different products. We're going to look at places where people go to consume these beverages and how they all interact. Things are built around the actual beverage itself.
By the Glass. Thursdays from 6 to 7, only on SoFloRadio.com.
SoFloRadio.com is the exclusive radio home of the Fort Lauderdale Strikers Football Club. Listen for every corner kick, penalty kick, save, and goal on SoFloRadio.com.
To Anderson, the save by, the save by Gorick, but the put back by Darnell King, and the Strikers are up 2-0.
Silverman on Sports host Bruce Silverman brings you the play-by-play.
SoFloRadio.com, bringing you every Striker home game.
Starting live at 7:30. SoFlo Radio. Talk, music, sports. SoFloRadio.com.
The Amigo Show with Larry Million.
Yeah, I said it. Michael Jordan was the biggest thing in the NBA. LeBron is the biggest thing in the NBA. Same type of star. I'm not going to argue who's better today. And you look at that, right, Frank? And I remember Jordan Like, I rooted against Jordan. You know why I rooted against Jordan?
Woo!
Oh, my God. My voice went soprano. Oh, my
God. What I meant to say was... What I meant to say was when I... Do you know why I root against?
You have failed.
That's what I was trying to say.
The Amigo Show, Saturday mornings from 9 to noon, only on SoFloRadio.com.
You are listening to The Amigo Show with Larry, the Amigo Million.
Hi, I'm looking for Ray Finkel. And a clean pair of shorts.
On SoFloRadio.com.
Soccer-style kicker, graduated from Collier High, June 1976, Stetson University Honors graduate, class of 1980, holds two NCAA Division I records, one for most points in a season, one for distance, former nickname the Mule, the first and only pro athlete ever to come out of Collier County, and one hell of a model American.
Having a little fun with our folks on Ustream here on the Amigo Show, SoFloRadio.com. Great song. Our next guest was one of about 50-plus thousand in the building. I think in 20 years, like 350,000 people will say they were there. I got my ticket stub to prove it, though. He was there doing a little work for the New York Yankees. He does some work for us here on the Amigo Show. Always comes on. Always a great guest. I always mention how that damn three-run homer in that World Series to tie up a game that the Yankees needed so badly was the start of a minor man crush that I have on him. Not as big as my man crush on Derek Jeter, of course, but this guy is the man as well. Jimmy Leyritz joining us here on the Amigo Show on SoFloRadio.com. What's up, Jimmy? How's everything going?
It's going good, Larry. How you been, man?
I'm doing good, buddy. Everything good with you?
Yeah, everything's good out here in Southern California and enjoying some of this Southern California finally playoff baseball since I can't go to New York and watch it this year.
Unbelievable what this week in baseball has been. Before we get to that, let's get to Thursday so we can leave it in the past. A week ago Thursday, I know we didn't get a chance to see each other because that place was a zoo, no pun intended. My goodness, Hollywood writes that script, right? Spielberg writes that script, sends it in, and somebody says, that movie will suck. That's not realistic. That would never happen. And yet with Jeter, it always seems to happen. What a great end to a great career in Yankee Stadium. The theater was just beyond belief. I don't know if people around you were in tears. Myself and the little amigo were in tears, and when I looked around, everybody was in tears. It's 10 days later or 9 days later. It's still hard for me not getting choked up just talking about it. I wanted to get your thoughts about being in the building, what you witnessed, your thoughts about Jeter's career, how the fans received him, and everything that led up to that moment.
Well, yeah, it was a crazy night. I mean, everybody was back from the old teams up in the suites, and everybody's walking around in the early innings, and we were all talking about. Every time Derek came up to hit, we all went out with our cameras and, you know, we were taking pictures because we all felt the same way, that this was kind of the end of our era also. And, you know, I was in the suite with David Cohn and David Wells. And, we were walking around. We got to see everybody. They took Torrey and all them guys down there to do the little thing that Joe Girardi had planned. And so we kind of all sat there, and as soon as Dave Robertson gave up the two home runs, we just looked at David Wells and I just looked at each other, and I said, "Well, you know, I guess the script's going to be a little bit different." And sure enough, you know, Derek rewrote it any better, couldn't have written it any better than what he did. And to have that kind of a moment, to have that kind of a walk off, it's pretty much, you know, we always said. It was funny because the whole week we were saying, what will Derek do to top the 3,000 hit, the Mr. November. What will he do to top that? You know what? He did it. And I, like you said, CC Sabathia even said it. If I was sitting in a movie theater, I would have walked out and said, this is a joke.
Well, yeah. It wasn't a joke. That first inning at bat where he was probably inches away from going yard. My goodness. That was a thrill. Never did I imagine that a few hours later, he would leave me in tears. Jim Leyritz joining us here on the Amigo Show. Again, you can tell I get choked. It's very hard for me to talk about. You know, as you've known me for so many years, what he represents to me as a fan. Because you know, one thing is Radio Larry, and the other thing is you know Yankee fan Larry. And what he represents to me as a fan of the game and a fan of the Yankees. I looked around, and there wasn't a dry eye anywhere near us at that point. And obviously, my son was in tears. But I think leading into that ninth inning when it was 5-2, I made a comment out loud, kidding around, saying, come on, O's, let's get three back so Jeter can walk it off. And some people giggled. Now, I'm not saying that was a prediction because I did say it in jest. But when the two-run jack came up, a couple of people looked at me. And then when the guy hit the home run to tie the game, somebody goes, hey, you're going to get your wish. And it was something that I never imagined. It was on top of all the drama that came that night, the rainbow that came out 5 minutes before game time in a game that was supposed to be rained out, yet there wasn't one drop of rain throughout the entire game. In between innings, all the beautiful things they put up on the screen for him. Just an unbelievable tribute to him, to the fans chanting, thank you, Jeter, which was, I think, overwhelming for him and for a lot of us in that stadium understanding what was going on at that point in time. To lead up to that moment where I will always have that memory with my son, honest to goodness, I have never in my life, as a fan, as a guy who covers sports, I've never experienced a moment like that. You've been around the game a long time. Is this hard to top?
Well, I mean, I was there for Pete Rose's hit. That was pretty special. That was a record that no one ever thought would be broken. And when Pete broke that record, that was a pretty special moment in Cincinnati. And to see him do it with his son there and his family and everybody else, so that was pretty big. But, no, I like I said, knowing Jeter, knowing his family, knowing his mother and father, and just to have that moment that, you know, it was, again, you have to remember, Larry, we were up in the suites with all these, with the Jeter family, with all the players, all the guys. So we kind of knew what was going on. As far as, you know, the Jeter family being brought down to the first row, you know, I think you heard the story. I'm sure that the way it was supposed to happen was Robertson was supposed to close the game out. The whole team was going to run and get Jeter at shortstop and make him take a lap. And as he's made the final lap into home plate, that Joe Torre and all them would be there to walk him off in the sunset, the core four.
I didn't know that was what they were going to do. Until this moment you just said it, I had no idea that's what they were going to do.
Yeah, that was the plan, the planned ending that the Yankees had. And it was funny because Joe Torre, DeSada, and the core four guys were all down in by the batting cages, all right? And Jeter didn't know that. And when Robertson blew the save, he kind of walked in and said, you know, sorry, guys, I kind of blew the ending, you know. And then all of a sudden it turned out like it did, and it couldn't turn out any better. But that was the whole thing, that Jeter was supposed to be, you know, when they went up 5-2, Girardi, you know, it was hilarious because they were all on the phones on a walkie-talkies trying to organize this whole thing. And so they brought everybody down real quick, and they had the Jeter family in the first row, and then they had Torre and all them underneath. And that, the idea was, as soon as the game was going to end, Joe Girardi, when they went out for the inning, Joe Girardi told everybody on the bench, as soon as the game's over, run and create a wall so Derek can't leave the field, and he can't see home plate. And so while he was going to take his lap, the core four and Torre and Bernie and them were going to be right there at home plate, ready to walk him off into the sunset.
That's I'm glad that you shared that with me. I had absolutely no idea of this, and it was a magical evening. You've met my son. What my son's reaction was about as golden as the moment in itself. I'm curious as to the reactions of the former players, because obviously they're a little desensitized. I don't think, like, a fan takes a different perspective to it. I'm getting the impression that those guys, probably not tears, but certainly big smiles from guys like you're talking about, you with David Wells and the core four was there. I know Bernie was there. Mr. T was there. Like, that had to be that just for you, even though these are people that you played with and you were part of that. You know, you weren't on the outside like a guy like me, but you're in the inside of that. Even still, that had to be some kind of moment for you to be around these people and around the moment at that time.
Well, I can tell you this much. You know, again, I was up with David Cohen and David Wells up in his suite. And, you know, we all had our iPads out taping it, you know, taping the last at bat. And I can tell you when he first came up, yeah, there was a little tear. Little say, this is it. This is his last at bat. This is ending. And then, like Derek said, it went from, yeah, you were thought you were going to break down and cry, to all of a sudden you were so excited that he hit, you know, got the game-winning hit and that you were actually cheering. And it wasn't, you know, like he said, you know, he thought he was going to lose it. And I think he would have lost it had they closed the game out in the ninth inning there and he was standing at shortstop with nowhere to go. I think he would have lost it then. But with getting the game-winning hit, being so excited, it was tough to have tears. And I think that's how all of us were. Like, we were all sad when he first came up and knew that was going to be his last at bat. At the same time, the excitement of the game-winning hit was tremendous.
Jim Leverich joining us here on the Amigo Show. Well, we were in tears, and certainly it was a strange way to kick off 10 days of baseball that have been incredibly exciting. You went from that moment, you went to the final weekend of the season, in which the final day there was, you know, three big games to decide the fate, and then you went into the wild card playoffs. What the Royals did that first night in the wild card playoffs, come back four different times to win that game, to what we've seen over the last few days, including just culminating into last night's Eric Hosmer two-run homer, Royals winning their third consecutive extra inning game. This, I mean, Jeter couldn't have left it any better, because since he said goodbye, like, baseball has been on the tip of everyone's tongue. It's been exciting stuff, exactly what the game needed. Your thoughts on how things are going? Are you surprised at the Royals? And your thoughts at from the playoffs from here on? Like, who do you think goes forward, and who do you think has a shot to go to the World Series?
Well, you know, to me, the thing that I love about the postseason is I'm not a big sabermetrics guy. I'm not a big guy in the stats and everything else, because when you get to the postseason, throw all that out. Because I'm sorry, but if you're watching these games and you see that Clayton Kershaw has a 7-2 lead and they end up losing and Wainwright gets up all these runs, a sabermetric person or somebody that would tell you the odds or everything else, you couldn't predict what's going on in these games. The Kansas City Royals, you know, that play-in game, I think, creates so much buzz and so much confidence, especially in that young team, that coming back, like you said, three or four times, all of a sudden you get to the next round or the next game, and you don't ever feel like you're out of it. Like, they might give you two or three runs or four runs, be down by it, but you don't ever feel like out of it, and the momentum can carry through, and I think that's what you're seeing. I think the Giants got the momentum going. They got off to a great start. You know, Jake Peavy pitched a great game yesterday. But the bottom line is, some of these scenarios that we've happened in the postseason can be predicted by stats or sabermetrics. And that's what I love about the postseason. It's the guys you don't expect. It's the guys that, you know, the numbers aren't there. And when you look at some of these, you know, the all-star players, you know, those numbers are a little bit scary, especially if you're looking at the Angels. You know, with those guys, that first four guys in their lineup, they have not been able to swing the bats very well. So, again, it's a whole different ball game once the postseason starts.
Are you surprised that the Tigers, with all the pitching, is losing to the team with all the hitting? I mean, like, obviously the Orioles coming back from 6-3 yesterday, bases clearing double by Delmon Young. Doesn't surprise me, because Delmon Young is a 21st century version. I shouldn't say that because you played in the 21st century, but he's just Jim Leyritz 2.0. I'm sorry. Like, you need a big hit in a playoff game should bring Delmon Young up to the plate, because my goodness, does this guy crush the ball in October. It's been a series of stories. We just talked about the Royals. I just bring up the Orioles. You see Clayton Kershaw, what seemed to be he was rolling, and then all of a sudden the wheels came off the train. I mean, it's been borderline exhilarating as far as baseball playoffs, and if you're a baseball fan, and what's going to but my question goes back to, are you surprised that in that series pitching is not beating the hitting?
Yeah, I mean, that's what you thought. You know, with three Cy Young Award guys, you know, Baltimore having the year that they had, you know, it is interesting that you're having these high scoring games. You know, but the one, you know, the big question is, you know, whether or not that Detroit bullpen can find someone to shut things down, because they've had the opportunity twice. They just have not been able to capitalize on it. And, you know, it's been a sore spot going into this playoffs. And it's really reared its head because, you know, but the one thing I will tell you this much that I love about, you know, playing for Buck Showalter and playing under Buck Showalter is just that watching his team, watching that team, how well prepared it is. And that's why I think, again, they to me, I think they're the favorite. I think they've been very quiet. They're not flashy, but everyone there knows their job. I see it being a Baltimore, Kansas City, ALCS, and then you know what? From there, I'm not even willing to predict, because between those two teams, anything can happen. Because you got young players who are experienced to play out for the first time, and right now are going on adrenaline and going on, you know, just what has developed over the last couple of days.
Jimmy, the National League, obviously, we just discussed the Dodgers. Jim Leyritz joining us, by the way, here on the Amigo Show. The Dodgers and, you know, in that series against the Cardinals. I guess the Cardinals, you know, those two teams don't necessarily love each other. We saw there was almost a little brawl and whatnot. Dodgers losing game one. I wouldn't count the Dodgers out just yet. They've got a perfect balance of things. Wanted your thought on the National League, Nationals losing their first game at home to the Giants. Like, are we looking at another California, you know, contingent here in the National League Championship Series? Like, do you think it's the Dodgers and the Giants, or do the Nats really have an opportunity here to bounce back and play the kind of baseball they've been playing all season, which basically put them atop the National League? Your thoughts on the National League and who would move forward from there?
Well, once again, the thing Joe Torriari used to say to us was, you're only as good as your next day starter. And really, it's what it comes down to. And, you know, Andy Pettit in game one in 96, you know, got killed, but came back in game five and probably pitched the best game of his entire life. These big-time pitchers, these guys like this, you know, once in a while they're going to have a breakdown, but usually that responds with even a better performance the next time. And if the Dodgers can get this to game five and give Kershaw the ball, I think they, you know, it's going to be a whole different scenario this next time around. And I really truly believe that. I'm, you know, again, being Don Mattingly's, you know, biggest advocate, biggest fan, I'm praying that he gets that chance and gets that opportunity. With Greinke going, I think that, you know, the Dodgers are in good shape. And it's just a matter, like I said, of getting it to game five to where you don't have to bring Kershaw back on short rest.
Jimmy, before I let you go, you know, I've asked everybody this question on and off the air. Face of baseball now that Jeter's gone. A lot of people like to argue. I've had myriad of arguments, including the one that makes me think that Jeter's the greatest all-around shortstop of all time. I went to a meeting of baseball minds here in South Florida recently of old college coaches, minor league coaches, and managers, guys that really influenced the game, guys that affected baseball players' lives that are in the big leagues today and have been in the big leagues. And I asked one gentleman in particular who I respect as far as his baseball knowledge more than anyone else, and he thinks Jeter's the greatest shortstop of all time. So whether he is or isn't the argument. I think he really was the face of baseball leading up into his final at-bat at Fenway last Sunday. Now that that's said and done, who takes the throne? Because honestly, the game has been somewhat, you know, it's been struggling a little bit in the eyes of America. United States is we live in a society today that's a lot more ADD than it was when we were growing up. And I don't know, I think football and basketball seems to captivate the sport fan a lot more than baseball has recently. But with the events of this week, I think baseball's on the comeback. Who's that face that you want to put in front of the game?
Well, I think everybody's hoping it's going to be Mike Trout. Since Mike Trout has come up, he's been compared to Mickey Mantle, which is, of course, you know, Larry, you and I's pastime, one of our favorite guys.
Yep.
And now, he is considered probably the best player in baseball right now. The question is whether or not he's able to handle it the way Derek did. And listen, I don't think anybody is going to handle it or be able to be as good a face of baseball that Derek was. But we'll see, we may go a year or two, and there might be somebody else that comes along that, is fortunate enough to get caught up in 96, go to the playoffs 12 years in a row. And they really, Larry, do we think we can do that again? To me, that's going to be something that's going to be a very tough feat for anybody to be a part of. But I do think Mike Trout has the ability and has maybe the fortitude as far as on and off the field to be able to handle that.
Jim, man, I appreciate you coming on the program, talking a little baseball with us. It's always a thrill to talk to you. I regret not being able to see you at Yankee Stadium. I know how busy you were, so I knew it was impossible. I know you tried to get out to our section. You knew where I was, but you were entertaining way too many people. And you had too many things going on. So definitely I could understand that. Plus, I wasn't leaving my seat to go to you. I'm sorry. I was captivated by the game. And I'm just thrilled that I was there. And that's something that even though we weren't together, we can always share the memory that we were in the same place at the same time. So I appreciate you taking a few minutes to share your experience from your end, because there's some stuff there I had no idea, no clue whatsoever, and certainly it was great. I took the kid, we did the walk around, I took him to see where Stans was, I took a picture in front of the mural that comes out in the Gatorade commercial, got interviewed by Newsday for 10 minutes. I think they didn't use my stuff because they found out I was a member of the media, so what they do, they took a picture of my son and they put it on Newsday instead. But it was the ultimate guy's trip with my 9-year-old, something he'll never forget. I think I got past the whole thing that I didn't get to see Reggie Jackson hit his 3 home runs when I was 9. So I took my 9-year-old to see Yankee history, and it was just a wonderful experience. I appreciate you coming on the show to talk a little bit about that, a little bit about Major League Baseball playoffs, and hope to have you again on real soon. Remember, when you're in Miami, got to give me a buzz, man. I owe you a dinner.
I definitely will, Larry. Thanks for having me, man.
Love you, man. Take care of yourself.
All right, you too, brother.
That's Jim Leyritz joining us on the program. Yeah, I'm putting it on thick here with Jeter because you know what happens next week, right?
No more Jeter talk.
I can't talk about it. I can't. No matter how much I want to, I can't. Well, once upon a time, it was the whole LeBron thing that I couldn't get over. Wait, hold on. Did I just say his name? Here you go, LeBron.
Toma.
Toma. Right-handed, left-handed, uh-huh. Both hands. I'll give you the Johnny Football. Since you like Johnny Football so much, I'll give you the Johnny Football middle fingers when we come back. Final segment of the program when we come back. We hope we can get Kenny Anderson on. I'm not sure if he's available or not yet. I'm going to give him a call on the break when we come back. It will be the final segment of the program here on SoFloRadio.com. Remember, you can catch the Fort Lauderdale Strikers. Work with me, Larry. Fort Lauderdale Strikers tonight, 7:30. Play-by-play done by Bruce Silverman. They're playing the Silverbacks from, is it Charlotte?
Charlotte.
Charlotte Silverbacks. They're playing tonight, 7:30. So you can always catch your Fort Lauderdale Strikers.
Carolina Railhawks.
Charlotte. Carolina.
What did you say? They were called?
Silverbacks. I don't know. What's wrong? I tried to do it off my memory. I'm just jittered up right now. We'll be back.
You're listening to SoFloRadio.com.
Escape with your loved one to your own private fantasy world at the totally renovated Miami Princess Hotel, 4251 Northwest 11th Street, next to the airport in Miami. Unlock the secrets of your imagination in one of our 8 exotic theme rooms. Journey to the Orient in the Japanese room. Ancient delights await in the Roman room. Be the king of your jungle in the Tarzan room. Breathtaking suites designed to provide the utmost of intimacy. Miami Princess Hotel, located close to I-95 and the airport. Give them a call, 305-441-1862. That's 305-441-1862.
By the Glass.
By the Glass is a show about beverage culture.
Brett Hubbard.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to connect the dots on how everything works together. It's really all about how we enjoy things, how we enjoy life, and how beverages play a big part in that. I'm going to bring in people that are going to display their aspect of the culture. I'm going to bring in people that are going to show you different products. We're going to look at places where people go to consume these beverages and how they all interact. Things are built around the actual beverage itself.
By the Glass. Thursdays from 6 to 7. Only on SoFloRadio.com.
Hi, this is Boca, and I'm not a tranny, but I do play one on radio. Here's my before picture, and here's my after picture. And I owe it all to Luis the Artiste and his new outstanding weight loss program, the Powwow.
All systems are functional.
And you pass the reins to Mr. Jackal, the new king of radio.
Is there life on other planets?
This is nuclear physicist Stanton Friedman, and now I'm a voice in the Jackal's head.
Is the government keeping secrets from us?
This is Stephen Bassett, and I am now a voice inside the Jackal's head.
Want to find out more? Listen to the Jackal's Head on the Soup Media Network.
The biggest trick the Jackal ever pulled was to convince the world that he doesn't exist.
You are listening to The Amigo Show with Larry, the Amigo Million.
My name's Noah Jaybird.
Noah Jaybird?
Ka-ka!
Oh, you like to fly.
What's your name, baby?
They call me Soul Baby.
Soul Baby?
Yeah.
Keep it in control, baby. Tears, no fears, man.
Oh, is that right?
Respect it, don't neglect it.
All right, my brother.
Treat it, don't beat it, my
All
man.
All right, baby.
On SoulFlowRadio.com.
You're a badass mother...
Now, the end is near. And so I face the final curtain.
You know what?
My friend,
I'll walk from here.
I'll say it clear. I'll state my case.
Seven, fellas.
I'm certain.
Let's win it.
We are.
Hey. This is Stan.
We've been waiting for you to come in here since 98 at the least.
You never invited me.
We're here now. Thank you.
I'm signing this old man. All right. Captain, all right, buddy?
Yeah,
captured your spirit.
Hello.
I'm older, I don't know these things.
Me either.
Captain!
What is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way.
Final segment of the program, 954-990-0036. Thanks for playing that, dude.
Dude, it got me finally. I got some teary-eyed, too. That's crazy, man. I like the expressions on everybody's face on that commercial.
What's happening, fellas, when he says that to the kids playing in the park? Like, that's just me being a dork.
I put myself in their shoes.
He's like, just
that's awesome,
he's
man.
A dude. He's a guy. Sup, fellas? Happening, fellas? And just, that was a great experience. I'm glad I was able to share that with you guys. I'll file it away in history and probably won't bother you anymore with Jeter. But before I do that, two quick things. Hopefully we can get Kenny Anderson to call in. Should be calling in. Let me send him this. Okay. But I want to share the fact that I think that Keith Olbermann is a douchebag. Right, so he went on a rant talking about how Jeter wasn't the greatest player of all time, which made no sense because nobody ever said he was the greatest player of all time. Then after the hit, he made some more stupid comments. And I can't help but think to myself in reference to Olbermann, you are criticizing a guy who's been at the top of his game, at the top of his trade, who's conducted himself with class, with dignity, with consistency. And you, dude, like, I'm not one to talk because I'm not, you know, I'm not a world beater when it comes to radio ratings. But my goodness, man, you're a piece of garbage too, dude. Like, make up your mind. Are you politics? Are you sports? You want to sabermetric your way into proving that Jeter sucks as a shortstop? You're a clown, bro. Like, honestly, like, you gained little favor with people and lost a lot of respect from those who liked you from going down that road. your show's about to be canceled because it sucks balls. And then, you know, you think that this is all funny and smarmy and cute. And quite frankly, you're a jackass with no historical. I don't care what, who you belong to and how people regard you as knowing about baseball. Guys who have forgotten more baseball than you'll ever know, like Peter Gammons and just a few others, will tell you that he's the greatest shortstop of all time, but they would never say he's the greatest player of all time. So you took something, you took it out of context, you went down the road you wanted to go in. I always wanted to say this on the air. We weren't on the air last week. Oberman, you're a jackass, bro. And I would love to tell you that to your face, because it's like you're allowed and entitled to your opinion. And I know some people on Twitter thought that it was just because it was my opinion. But one thing is to think he's not the greatest shortstop. Another thing is to say something nobody's ever said to try to make a point and shine attention on yourself. You're a fool. You're an absolute fool. The guy represented himself with class for 20 years, represented the city of New York and the game of baseball like nobody's business. Let him ride off into the sunset and keep some of these thoughts to yourself. If you don't think he's the greatest shortstop of all time, so be it. That's your opinion, and I respect it. But nobody in the world ever said he was the greatest player of all time for you to go on a 7-minute rant explaining why he wasn't the greatest player of all time when nobody ever said he was to begin with. I know one thing. You're not anywhere near being the greatest guy on TV in sports of all time. You certainly don't know crap about politics and sports, not enough to at least garner ratings to keep you on any show for a limited amount of time. And quite frankly, had you not, you know, had ESPN not left you, let's just say, or you left ESPN, I don't know what the story really is, but like it's been downhill for you ever since. So I'm the last one to talk, but quite honestly, like I think your comments were out of control, and no one really respects your comments. And for those of you who hate Jeter, and don't think he deserved the you know, the fanfare that he received this year and the last month and the last week, you're entitled to your opinion, and I respect it. But going on a tangent to hate a guy in sports, when we work in sports and we see how many people are jackasses in sports and knocking out their wives in casino elevators and domestic violence and drugs and all that nonsense. And I can forgive anyone. I don't ever cast the first stone. I like forgiving people. People make mistakes. But for crying out loud, are you kidding me? So anyway, I had to get that off my back before I get my man. Is he on? He just dropped.
Yeah, he just dropped. I'm going to try to come back.
All right, call him back right now real quick. But in the last 5 or 7 minutes, we'll talk to Kenny Anderson, talk a little bit. I got 2 NBA questions for him. And I have 1 question for him in reference to the Georgia Tech game. As you know, Kenny Anderson graduated from Georgia Tech, did some good work as a basketball player there and did some good work in the NBA. We got him on the phone. Kenny Anderson, my good friend on the show, on the Amigo Show. What's up, Kenny? How's everything going, buddy?
Larry, what's going on, my man?
How you doing, man? Are you proud of me? Am I representing New York a little better 3 times in 90 days? Is that a little better now?
Yeah, you represented New York. Now you just changed over now. You left all your stuff in the closet. Now you came back to Florida. Now you stepping all this money. You can't do that, man. I told you can't do that. You got to stay a New Yorker. Like, I don't understand.
Well, but wait a minute now. You know that I'm a lifelong Canes fan. It's hard to shake that one. And you know that I got a lot of guys that are friends of mine that played there and part of that historic program. So you know that comes from a different place. That has nothing to do with being a New Yorker. But I think the New York stuff, I think I've done good work, man. I mean, I flew my son out to see Jeter's last game. Like, I've been like I hadn't been there 3 times in the last 5 years, and I went 3 times in the last 88 days.
So I'll give you some love on that, but it's just funny, though, because I know you when you get up to New York, you change up. You're like, I'm a New Yorker. So you fly back down here, and you get on this Floridian thing. So it'd be funny, man. I just be like, look, I don't like New Yorkers like that.
Okay.
I live here.
I'll represent a little better.
I like the weather, man. That's about it. I'm New York, man. I'm not, you know, I just like the weather. It's good for my kids to grow up here. But other than that, I'm a New Yorker.
Well, Kenny, we're going to go back. How about that? I promise you, you and I are going to take a trip over there, and we're going to hang for a couple of days in New York, and I'll show you that I'm a real New Yorker. Got to give me a little credit, man. It's just too many years down here, too. I can't just turn my back on Miami. I know you haven't been here as long as I have, but I did high school down here, so you know it's a tough little tug of war for me. But it's been fun this summer, being back over back home and going back to my old stomping grounds and just feeling like a New Yorker again. That trip was a lot of fun. But it's time for reality, not just tonight's football game, which is not why I had you on, but some NBA basketball getting ready. Training camps are in. They're getting everything started. Exhibition season starting in just a few days. And the reality of the season just a few weeks away. Your thoughts on this NBA season that's going to be very exciting, some changes with teams like the Bulls and obviously the Cleveland Cavaliers. Your thoughts on what's going on in the NBA this year, who's going to be good, who's not?
Yeah, this is great. It's going to be a great year due to the fact that LeBron James went back home to Cleveland, and I thought that, you know, by him doing that, it spread the wealth. The East is going to be pretty good, but, you know, if I hope he rolls, I still have the Bulls to win the East if Rose play all games and he's healthy. I just think it's going to take a year or so, a year, or maybe half a year or so, for Cleveland to gel together. You know, Kyrie Irving is going to have a great year playing alongside LeBron. Kevin Love is going to play. It's going to be awesome. But now Kevin Love is in a situation where every night these games are going to count. There's more pressure on him. Because when he was playing in Minnesota, nobody really cared. You know, now it's pressure to win right away. They got some veterans in there. Sean Marion is there. They're set. But I just think gelling right away might be a problem. Got a new coach, Washington Wizards with Wall and Bill and backcourt. I mean, then they got Blair up court and then Gortat still there, Nene. They got a very good team in Washington this year. I think the experience of Bill and John, what they learned last year, is going to help them. Toronto, I thought, probably didn't do much, but they was pretty good last year. They still got a great backcourt of Lowry and DeRose. That team is going to be pretty good. Charlotte, look at Charlotte. And it's great. The buzz is back. You know, Charlotte Hornets. And they got the two. I can't wait to watch them. Two New Yorkers, Larry did it. The two New Yorkers in the backcourt. Kimball Walker and Lance Stevenson. New Yorker, baby.
Yep, Lance from Brooklyn. Lance is from Brooklyn. Yeah, so. And even though I didn't like him last year, I like the way he plays the game, man. He plays it hard, and he's a baller, man. He can really do the work.
He's a baller. I think he's going to bring an edge to Charlotte with Jefferson in the middle, Kimber, and him in the backcourt. And they already was in the eighth spot last year, so they should improve. So I like the East. He's going to be pretty good, but I still believe if Cleveland comes out of the East, I think they might win it all. But I think the East won't win it all only if Cleveland comes out. I think Chicago might have a problem beating teams in the West in a playoff series. That's the difference I got, you know, with that happening. But I like the Spurs coming back with their same team. They're going to be pretty good. Mavericks. All good. I'm curious about Stephen Curry and Klay Thompson and their team. They got a lot of love last year, but now with Steve Kerr, I'm curious on how he's going to do after a great job that Mark Jackson did. How is he going to do, you know, with that team? How are they going to respond to him? I just think the West of Denver got a good team. You know, they didn't play as well last year. Phoenix is probably one of those teams that's going to be on the rise. You know, they got everybody back, and it's going to be an interesting season.
Kenny, before I let you go, because we're up against the end of the show, you know, Colin Cowherd this week talked about 17 basketball teams that would be pretty good, winning 40 games or more. He didn't mention the Heat. Do you think the Heat finished 500 this year?
Yeah, I have to believe so. And I like the Heat. I'm not a huge fan. I like the Heat.
I know you do.
My guy Mike Lipset, you know, looks out for me, you know, with tickets. So But losing a guy like LeBron James is going to hurt them a great deal. But I still believe Wade got some gas in the tank. And Chris Bosh, who, yes, you know, he is a yellow jacket for the Tech for a year. He will have a great year, numbers-wise. You know, he's going to be – I would look for him to get those Toronto Raptors numbers. But I don't think they're going to be a bad team. They're going to have to get used to it. It's going to be shell-shocked probably for them the first month and a half, two of the season, because they relied. But I still like the team they have.
I'm sure you'll be sitting watching the game at Bobby Dodd tonight between the Miami Hurricanes and the
Yellow Jackets.
And your Yellow Jackets.
The Yellow Jackets will swarm. We are going to swarm all through the cage, that Hurricane nonsense. We swarm. They go night, Larry.
We'll see, man.
They in ATL. They in ATL. It's white out. It's white out right now. It's going to be awesome, baby.
I'm going to be texting you tonight, man.
I will wear it tomorrow morning. You will see me around in my song, whatever. My GT gear on. You will see it.
Well, we got to get together, man. I know your birthday's coming up soon, so let's plan on it. I'll be texting you tonight, busting chops, man.
All right.
I love you, bro. My man.
I love you. Thanks.
Take care. Kenny Anderson, what a show today, baby. Great guest list. Thanks goes out. Alonzo Highsmith, Will Mansell, Melvin Bratton, Jimmy Leyritz, and, of course, Kenny Anderson. You just heard him on the show here on the Amigo Show, SoFloRadio.com. I had a great time, Frank. Good job.
Blast.
Appreciate it.
Let's go Canes.
Let's go Canes. I think the Canes are going to take it to him.
I know.
Stay warm. Stay warm if you're in Atlanta. Enjoy the game. Enjoy Major League Baseball. Go Royals. And beyond that, I'll let you go. Thanks for a good time today, and as always, the Amigo Show is my pleasure. It's my duty, and obviously, it's my privilege to talk to you guys about sports. Thanks, guys. See you next week.
You're listening to SoFloRadio.com.